Okay, so with this paper, we aim as well to contribute to the discussion to the open data in archaeology. In particular, we will focus on a research-oriented spatial data infrastructure, SDI, and we'll question how we can integrate the 3D data into it. Archaeologists quickly became involved in the INSPIRE directive and on the open data movement. They have been heavily involved in the construction of the spatial data infrastructure that have been flourishing for less than 10 years now. Several groups have developed conceptual thinking on relevant data models to homogenize records, share the so-called cultural data, including built and landscape heritage, and this on an international and pan-European level. Many groups have also been thinking about the scheme for organizing the sharing of the geocatalog and dataset for different users, and here you have the Arkland SDI scheme, for example. And from the beginning of this reflection, it was underlined that it is necessary to integrate a 3D geometry, which is essential for the characterization of cultural entities, but for the moment we don't have so many examples on it. Nevertheless, all these works are generally made toward end user to make accessible the data. But without really integrating the investment required from the data provider who is producing the data, and in particular the researcher. So in practice, in our research institution, data and metadata server were set up fairly quickly. And the suppliers, so the researchers, were asked to enter their data into this system. Technically, the articulation of the server by harvesting and data dissemination in the form of a web service has been developed rather convincingly. And in the end, we can say that the conceptual and the technical challenges of making spatial data accessible to a large European public is rather a success. But at least in France, one can wonder about the viability of such a system for archaeological data. And this for a different reason. In fact, if the boss, the general public, and the researcher themselves are very happy to have easily access to spatial data, by contrast, to supply the system as a producer of data leaves rather doubtful. This explains the fiasco or half fiasco of current infrastructure, such as CARGOS, which is a project we have developed a few years ago with the Maison des Sciences de l'Homme de Dijon. Why is this happening? First, because the time and human resource necessary for valorization and sharing spatial data are insufficient or not taken into account in the research project. Second, because the standards used for data and metadata are still too complex for a researcher who is not a specialist of this issue, even if they are producing their own spatial data. And finally, the benefit on the investment for the researcher appears too low to generate a real motivation, and it doesn't. And in addition, it doesn't solve or partially the issue of the data production within a research group. Therefore, it was time for us to redesign the structure of our SDI to meet the need of the researcher. Who produced the spatial data in 2D and by extension in 3D. So, on this basis, within our platform, on geomatic platform GeoBFC, common to the Maison des Sciences de l'Homme and Maison des Sciences de l'Homme de Besançon, sorry, et de Dijon, we developed a new conceptual system, conceptual scheme for organizing and sharing spatial information. with the researcher as a data producer in mind. Practically, what we propose is an original scheme which is based on a file sharing tools and on a geospatial web server. To link both of them, our team developed a specific tools, so-called GeoSync. And GeoSync allows the automatic publication and synchronization of data on a special data infrastructure based on the GeoOrchestra. So practically, researchers are producing their data with their own application, whatever, QGIS or ArcGIS. They deposit the data and the associated metadata on the spatial data infrastructure based on GeoOrchestra, and they deposit this data on directly online an online data sharing platform, based on OnCloud. Then this data can be shared with the other user and via the user GeoOrchestra. And when you share with GeoOrchestra, then it sends your data to the GeoOrchestra GeoServer and the metadata to the GeoOrchestra GeoNetwork for publication. Data becomes de facto available for download using flows are defined by the OGC, like WMS and so on. And the data vectors and raster files are centralized on the PostgreSQL JS database on the SDI. The metadata XML files are modified on the fly to insert links to published data layer on the GeoServer. And a unique ID is also used to ensure that the same metadata file will always have the same ID, regardless of who is publishing it. Then a cleaning system automatically unpublishes all data the user no longer wish to share with the SDI. And for the moment, all the metadata are public and accessible by any internet user. But on the other hand, the data themselves are accessible only to the user who has the right based on the OnCloud sharing system. So our GeoOrchestra special data infrastructure operates in a Docker environment, and so it is transferable. And for more information, the project is on the GitHub. So if the system works quite successfully, the 3D data remains out of the system, and it's still a problem for us, especially in archaeology. As far as we know, two types of solutions are developed nowadays. The first one is to connect the 3D viewer in a web mapping soft like LISMAP, for example, to show georeferenced layer in 3D. And the second approach is to map in 2D over a 3D point cloud with spatial information. As it is the case, for example, in this remarkable project via Apia, made by the University of Amsterdam. But what we would like to do is really to integrate the 3D data as a real spatial data within the spatial data infrastructure, like GeoOrchestra.
Okay, so I will take over from here. So what I will provide you is a broad overview of what is available right now as solution for 3D integration, what we can do, and what we will be able to do in the near future. So if we move the scope of the investigation toward 3D data integration, one of the main technical conflict happens between spatial and non-spatial data. First, we must acknowledge that most stratified formats does not allow to use geographical coordinates. In most applications, 3D models are displayed through a Cartesian coordinates with an abstract unit system. We have here on the slide a small list of more or less specialized applications that works relatively well for archaeology and cultural heritage, such as Sketchfabs, I think most of you know, or 3DO. Second, we must also acknowledge that most 3D recordings for cultural heritage and archaeology possess spatial information, very accurate GPS data for LiDAR or EXIF data with basic GPS coordinates from your camera or your phone. And that keeping track of this component has an obvious added value. It provides invaluable context and hierarchy in a constantly growing pool of linked 3D data. And units and scale are clearly defined, and it enables us to run basic or even complex spatial measurements and analysis. So I will launch a small video. It should be working, I guess. Yeah. So we are really interested in the possibility of displaying 3D spatial data through a web application. And among the growing number of available applications, there are some really outstanding open source solutions that I will present to you very quickly. The first I would like to introduce is Cesium, because of its inherent flexibility and versatility. It's an open source JavaScript library for displaying 3D globes and maps. Among other things, it's possible to display heterogeneous spatial datasets, such as meshes, point clouds, rasters, and vectors. For this, it's relying on efficient file formats and indexing, such as the newly published GLTF2, and most of them being derived or associated with the JSON standard. It is possible to link the data with databases, either SQL databases or NoSQL ones, and it's under active development with the upcoming releases of new platforms that I will introduce at the end of the presentation. You can see on the video behind me a proof of concept with various datasets. Now it's vectors over raster data from the Chambord area in France. So I will just let the video move forward. Here you can see a point cloud. So that's an older version of Cesium, but the new one is more efficient in displaying a massive point cloud. Okay, next one. It's a bit of a mix. It's called Teria. It's another interesting open source alternative. It is Leaflet, so the well-known web mapping application is merged with Cesium that I just showed you under an unified interface. The idea behind Teria is to be able to switch smoothly between 2D and 3D visualization in order to accommodate most devices regardless of performance and most use case scenario. On the downside, it's overall a bit slower than a well-optimized specific Cesium or Leaflet application. So this is the 3D part. Finally, Potree, that I think you also know, is also an open source JavaScript library for displaying efficiently massive point clouds data on the web. It enables us to create quickly simple visualization of point cloud datasets, such as the one of Chambord that you can see on the top of the slide. Being no part of the Last Tools package, anyone can produce this kind of visualization tool without knowing much about JavaScript. So it is also possible to produce more complex applications, such as the one you can see on the video. It is displaying an area near the city of Autun in France, where we were running multiple excavations each year, along with an extensive survey campaign ranging from long-range to close-range remote sensing. Through Potree, we fuse multi-resolution and multimodal data. Since it works with JavaScript, it's possible to have synergy with Cesium and to have Potree as an overlay on the globe, and it can prove very useful for specific usage where Cesium toolset for point cloud is not enough. So to move on a more technical point of view, point cloud should not be regarded as intermediate product, used solely for the purpose of producing what is still seen as a real finished product, most of the time a mesh. In my opinion, they have become a viable visualization medium by themselves and have some inherent advantages over meshes and are globally more easy to deal with. First, they are the default byproduct of most 3D application and 3D acquisition systems, as exposed in the table on the top of the slide. Even radar data that can be displayed as point clouds, this is ideal from a data fusion point of view. Second, because of the use of efficient out-of-core design with multi-resolution octree dynamic rendering that you can see on my left. They handle very well highly multiscalar data, as we have seen with the OTAN dataset. They inherently possess a simple data structure, point in space with a large amount of possible attributes, from color to physical properties. And because point cloud file format were originally developed for LiDAR data, they are natively supporting geographical coordinates. Lastly, point clouds are as accurate as the recording itself, whereas mesh provide only a surface approximation derived from the points. Consequently, point clouds have a higher metrological value. Point clouds have clearly the upper hand when it comes to set up a simple semi-automated pipeline for 3D data visualization for single file pre-visualization. The idea is to produce a 3D viewer for each ready file hosted on the spatial data infrastructure. With basic data submission rules, it is possible with JDAL and PCL libraries to run some testing and checking routine, which will be able to produce derived information, such as the spatial footprints and technical metadata that could be aggregated to pre-existing metadata. Next, a validated point cloud can be re-indexed with size in mind, either using Potri converter or the Docker Antoine toolbox. Then it can be displayed through Potri. The process produces interoperable data, reusable for more complex application than a simple single file pre-visualization. It can also be part of an iterative process where we merge multiple last datasets and use Antoine indexing to handle a newly produced massive datasets. So I don't know if you have seen them, but the Netherlands have, for example, a Potri application where you can see the LiDAR for the entire Netherlands, and it's working with Antoine indexing. So lastly, heterogeneous 3D datasets are more complex to handle, as we have seen. Mixing rasters, 3D, enhanced vector, 3D meshes, and point clouds into the same application is not an easy task. The upcoming SESAM Young Cloud architecture should ease what not so long ago was a complex process of data integration. It's a Docker-based multi-server platform that makes heavy use of AWS, so Amazon Web Services, while being modular for local hosting as an on-premises solution. The most critical feature is a so-called tiling pipeline. It requires to be automated, robust, and efficient when tiling of heterogeneous data, such as imagery, terrain, point clouds, photogrammetry, BIM, and more. From a technical point of view, batch scales horizontally and allow granular pager basis processing through the use of Docker images in a microservice-like architecture fashion. I can't say more about this pipeline right now because I haven't yet to test it live, but it is a matter of weeks. I think the release will be in May. But the technical specification you can see on the screen provided by the developers clearly gives the impression that comprehensive 3D data integration pipeline will be possible to achieve way more easily than before. Thank you very much.